Okay, good afternoon. Difficult times, almost near the end. So my name is Gidi Stein. I'm a practicing physician for Meir Hospital, and I came to share with you a bit about my journey. And, you know, I always thought that teaching and practicing medicine would be the center of what I do. Thank you for that. But all that changed a few years ago when here in Israel, a 9-year-old boy died simply because his primary care physician clicked on the wrong entry in the pull-down menu list and gave him the wrong drug by mistake. He wanted to prescribe the boy with Singulair, which is a drug for asthma, but by mistake he clicked on the next entry in the pull-down menu, which was Syntrom, a warfarin, a very potent anticoagulant. And basically the current available systems, the rule-based systems, have failed to identify the tragedy, and the boy fell off his bike a week later, dying of intracranial hemorrhage. A classic example of a mistake that could only exist in computerized systems, because when we wrote down the prescriptions, we just knew what we had to write down. We didn't click on the wrong thing. And if you think about the tragedy, you know, it wasn't bad judgment on part of the physician. It was a typo. It's like killing someone with a typo, right? One would have thought there would be some kind of a cool spell checker to prevent this from happening, but apparently this is not the case. And looking at the flow, from a moment the physician clicked on the wrong entry until the boy actually took the medication, there were so many places down the line where all the information was available to the relevant stakeholders that would make them make the decision, could make the decision that it's just the wrong drug for the wrong patient. The physician, the EMR, the insurance company, the pharmacy, even the patient's mother, just look at the leaflet. But still it slipped through the cracks. And this really shows that although it was a fault of a single individual, it really represents a failure of system. And a failure of system really necessitates a systematic way to try to really catch these and prevent these terrible mistakes. And the problem is huge. You know, it was discussed here before about billions and billions of dollars and hundreds of thousands of casualties and injuries, and I won't go into that. It also discussed the problem with the current rule-based solutions that missed many of the real random errors because they are rule-based systems, hundreds of thousands of rules. But more importantly, these systems generate way too many alerts, 20, 30%, as Ronen just described, with more than 90, 95% false alarm rates. And these cause alert fatigue in which physicians disregard the alerts altogether. So basically, if you have a system in place, basically, in most cases, patients are exposed to harm. And we thought, how can we change that? How can we bubble up those rare catastrophic events that can actually cause damage to our patients and bring them above the noise and clatter of the current rule-based systems, and so physicians will actually take action and change their behavior following these type of alerts? So we have to check on several boxes. First, the alert burden has to be very, very low. It doesn't make sense that physicians err 25% of the time. It doesn't make sense. Maybe less than 1%, maybe 0.5%, but not 10%. Mostly that doesn't happen. So we should reduce the alert burden substantially. And also, if 95 or 90% of the alerts are false alarms, immediately they will be ignored. And the last thing is that the alerts has to be actionable, meaning that physicians receiving them, even if it's my resident at 2 o'clock in the morning after I didn't sleep for 2 days or 26 hours right now and had maybe 15 patients admitted for each of them, he has to prescribe between 10 and 30 new medications. If the system flags 20% of the times, he will ignore it after the third time. And if it's not actionable, it's not clinically relevant, he will ignore all of them. And this was the challenge that we faced. So we looked at similar industries, that all of them had millions and millions of transactions. 99% of them were probably okay. But in some cases, these rare random events could cause harm. Industries such as cybersecurity and credit card fraud and aviation. And all of them started with these rule-based systems, but eventually found out that they were just not good enough and not performing well. And this is where they change gears and moved into machine learning and advanced algorithms for outlier detection. So basically, the ability of these algorithms, based on the data, to understand physician practice based on millions and millions of electronic medical records and identify outlier situations to the normal clinical behavior of physicians as potential errors and flag them at the point of care. But we're not focusing only at the moment of prescribing or dispensing, but knowing that most of the harm patients experience happen way after the medication was dispensed, in a post-prescribing, post-dispensing event when they're home or already admitted in the ward, when adverse drug events or evolving contraindications suddenly makes renders one of the active medications, which were okay only yesterday, suddenly dangerous today. So this is the arena, and this is what we are facing. And we created a system, again, based on AI, artificial intelligence, to try to identify these rare catastrophic events that can actually cause harm. And how does that work? The system sits in the back office, communicates all the time with electronic medical records in push and pull, extracts data, taps on everything that's going on in the hospital or the community setting in terms of data, applies the machine learning and models continuously to look for outliers, and when these outliers are found, go to the physician, present the alerts inside the workflow, inside the EMR, so they can take action. Just to give you samples of the stuff that we really found, right? Chemotherapy to a healthy young mother, 23-year-old woman came for a C-section. She had a chronic state of lupus, and instead of hydroxychloroquine, which is a drug for lupus, her gynecologist at the ward, by mistake, prescribed hydroxyurea, which is an oral chemotherapy. Very similar name. Right? Another case that we just encountered, a one-and-a-half-year-old baby with influenza, instead of Tamiflu for influenza, was prescribed with Tamofen, which is tamoxifen for breast cancer. Right? A patient with cardiovascular disease treated with aspirin for the last 10 years because of his post-myocardial infarction, but he was treated for B-cell lymphoma with chemotherapy. His platelet levels drop a few months later, and suddenly the active medication, the aspirin, that was okay only last week, suddenly became dangerous. Someone has to connect the dots and tell the physician, well, you know, it might be a good time to reevaluate the relevance of aspirin for that patient. Viagra to a two-year-old baby, obviously a mistake, and a fertility drug, ovulation medication basically to an 85-year-old dementic patient who had the name of a drug very similar to the osteoporosis drug. So obviously all of these are catastrophic errors. Anyone who looks at it understands it, but still it slipped through the cracks. Why? Because there are tens of millions of prescriptions in Israel every year, 4 billion prescriptions in the US every year, and even if it's a 1 in a million, it's much more than 1 in a million, things will slip through the cracks, and patients like that boy will die unnecessarily because of preventable medication harm. So after implementing the system, we actually put it to the test with several academic publications, some of them led by Dr. David Bates that Dr. Zimmerman just mentioned, really an advocate for patient safety and quality. And in that study, we analyzed 800,000 outpatient records from Mass General and the Brigham Women's Hospital in Boston. And out of these 800,000 files, we found 25,000 life-threatening errors with more than 75% accuracy that the current solutions did not find. And the research team have concluded that in the vast majority of the cases, the physicians should have changed their prescribing following the alerts that we provided. In a follow-up study, not only that the accuracy came from 75% to more than 85%, but we also found that more than 70% of the alerts that we provide are completely unique to our system and are not covered by any other system to date. And more than 60% of the alerts are generated way after the patient is home, post-prescribing, post-dispensing, because of evolving adverse drug events and contraindications that happen way after the medication is dispensed. And the alert burden is very, very low. Less than 0.5% for inpatients of prescriptions, less than 0.1% of prescriptions for outpatients. And this translates to almost 4% of hospital admissions with life-threatening errors that we could find, and about 1.5% of patients every year in ambulatory care with life-threatening errors that we could prevent. And this also translates to a very significant ROI, but that's not the main reason that we are here. So this is how it looks like. So this is the CPOE in the background, one of the US leading EMRs, Allscripts, for example. And when a patient tries to enter a new prescription for anticoagulation or antithrombotics, and the patient currently has thrombocytopenia, it will just pop up and say, hey, are you sure you want to do that? The patient has thrombocytopenia. A very short message, click and move on, no long things. In the middle of the night, my resident will definitely look into that. The next stage, the patient himself. Right now, Apple already has the ability to provide patients in the US with access to their own medical records in real time, and we can provide our insights on top of that, directly consumer-facing, directly enable them to take control of their own health. Currently, we're pretty much deployed in many hospitals and primary care clinics in Israel, also making our ways with leading institutions in the US, Harvard Medical School, Intermountain Healthcare, et cetera, with several partners, which are very interesting. But I think this is the most interesting slide. And going back to what Ronen just stated, how many physicians actually change their prescribing following the alerts that we provide? So we started 2017, 700 medications were stopped by the physicians changed following the alerts that we provided. Last year, almost 1,800. And this year will be more than 15,000. And this number is going to be substantially higher than that. The numbers are huge, and we could actually make the difference. And really, from my personal perspective, it really is unacceptable that anyone, let alone a child, would lose his life because of a click of a button. And we created middleware to ensure that this will never happen again. Thank you very much.